Today's lecture is based on artificial intelligence. The code for this particular subject is CS353. It is meant for 5th semester CSE Computer Science and Engineering students. And it is meant for July 2015, December 2015 batch. Now, let us talk about what is artificial intelligence. AI, for short, is a term which was coined by John McCarthy in the year 1956, and he gave this particular definition that science and engineering of making intelligent machines, intelligent computer programs. Now this definition itself has two parts. One is making intelligent machines, making intelligent computer programs. Now software and hardware components together are required to build up an artificially intelligent system. Further, AI deals with the intelligence of machines and also with the methodology of creating machines. Now, in this particular AI subject, we shall be studying about certain aspects of creation of knowledge-based systems, and also we shall be learning about the hardware, little bit of hardware and little bit of software through Prolog language and in the laboratory work. This AI also deals with the study of mental faculties and the use of computational models. Let us have a look at the textbooks that are available in the library. And we have D1, that is the Artificial Intelligence and Intelligent Systems by N.P. Pardi, Oxford University Press. We shall be forming it strictly as a textbook. The syllabus has been created from this particular book, which is written by a professor from IIT. And this book is available in the, several copies of this book are available in the library. The other books are also equally available. For reference sake, you can look at Introduction to Artificial Intelligence by Kernick and McDermott, Edison Wesley Publications. And further, you can look at Artificial Intelligence, A Modern Approach by Russell and Peter Norvig. This is very, very essential book. And but this book is slightly meant for PG program, so we shall be strictly following D1. Now this is the actually reference book, Artificial Intelligence and Modern Approach. There are several copies of this book are also available in the library. You can have a glance at it. Let us start with chapter 1. Now chapter 1 is strictly based upon the even textbook, and it shall cover the following topics: Introduction to Artificial Intelligence. Topics to be covered are History and Applications of AI, Fundamental Issues, Current Trends in AI. Now what is Artificial Intelligence? Let us have a look at it. It is the science and engineering of making intelligent machines, especially intelligent computer programs. It is related to similar task of using computers to understand human intelligence, but AI does not have to confine itself to methods that are biologically observable. Now this term AI is a mixture of science and engineering. It is dealing with making and understanding intelligent machines, especially intelligent computers and computer programs. Now what is intelligence? Let us talk about what is intelligence. Intelligence is the computational part of the ability to achieve goals in the world. Varying kinds of degrees of intelligence occur in people, many animals and some of the machines. Now intelligence is a word which generally varies from person to person. Say if we talk about the computational ability of a person may vary from person to person, and analytical ability also may vary from person to person. AI is a collection of hardware, hard problems which can be solved by humans and other living things, but for which we don't have good algorithms for solving. For example, AI deals with understanding of spoken natural language, medical diagnosis, circuit design, learning, self-adaptation, reasoning, chess playing, proving the math theories, etc. According to Webster's dictionary, the artificial intelligence is the capacity to acquire and apply applied knowledge, the faculty of thought and reason. This is the definition which has been taken from Webster's dictionary. And what features, abilities do humans or animals or animate objects have that we think are indicative or characteristics of intelligence? The sub areas of AI are perception, vision, speech, understanding, etc., machine learning, neural networks, robotics, natural language understanding, reasoning and decision making, search, planning, decision theory, knowledge representation, reasoning, logic, probabilistics. AI definition as given by Russell and Norvig in their book, that is, they have made two partitions, like humans, thinking like humans, acting like humans, thinking not necessarily like humans, acting not necessarily like humans. So we can see here, they have clearly bifurcated it into two parts. According to Turing test, the human intelligence can be further refined as a human interpreter communicates with a hidden subject, that is either a computer system or a human. If the human interrogator cannot reliably decide whether or not the subject is a computer, the computer is said to have passed the Turing test. So this definition was given by Turing, and it's a very famous definition. Turing provided some very persuasive arguments that system is passing the Turing test is intelligent. However, the test does not provide much traction on question of how to actually build an intelligent system. Human intelligence. In general, there are various reasons for trying to mimic humans might not be the best approach to AI. Computers and humans have very different architecture with quite different abilities. Numerical computations are different, visual and sensory processing, massively and slow, parallel versus fast serial. Now let us see what is the difference here. If we see here in this particular box, computers and human brain has been compared with several parameters. One such is computational unit, that is, in the case of computers, one CPU 10 raised to power 8 gates, and in the case of brain, it is 10 raised to power 11 neurons. Storage units, 10 raised to power 11 bits RAM, 10 raised to power 12 bits disk, 10 raised to power 11 neurons, 10 raised to power 14 synapses. Cycle time, 10 raised to power minus 9 seconds, 10 raised to power minus 3 seconds. Bandwidth, 10 raised to power 10 bits per second, 10 raised to power 14 bits per second. Memory, updates per second, 10 raised to power 9, 10 raised to power 14. So we can have a comparative picture between a computer and a human brain through the following parameters. Okay. But more importantly, we know that very little about how human brain performs its higher level processes, hence the point of view provides very little information from the scientific understanding of these processes can be made. However, neuroscience has been very influential in some areas of AI, for example, in robotic sensing, vision processing, etc. Computational intelligence, AI tries to understand and model intelligence as a computational process. Thus, we try to construct systems whose computational arc achieves or approximates the desired notion of rationality. It is the useful to think intelligent systems as being agents with their own goals, or that can act on behalf of someone. An agent, now it's defined here, agent is an entity that exists in an environment and that acts on that environment based on its perception of the environment. An intelligent agent acts to further its own interests and those of that of the user. Now let us have a look at the success stories of AI. In 1997, Deep Blue Computer defeated world-class champion Garry Kasparov in 6 games. This game of chess is purely based upon AI fundamentals, and the program defeated the world-ranking champion in 6 games. This AI is not only used in game designs, but also in other projects like in NASA and other areas of computation. The important issues of AI are: the system should act like humans, the system should think like humans, the system should think rationally, and the system should act rationally. These are the issues on which the AI is based, that is the artificial intelligence features are based, and they purely act according to these issues. Now let us have a look at the history of AI. AI has roots in number of scientific disciplines: computer science and engineering, hardware and software. AI is involved both for hardware as well as software. Philosophy, the rules of reasoning. Now rules of reasoning involve AI. Mathematics, logic, algorithms, optimization. Cognitive science and psychology, modeling high level human animal thinking. Neural science, model low level human animal brain activity. Linguistics, etc. Birth of AI, we can say from 1943 to 1956, within this era, the birth of AI, the concept of AI started when Pitts and Michelot in 1943 simplified the mathematical model of neurons. They designed the first model of neuron and can realize all propositional logic primitives. And Alan Turing gave Turing machines and Turing tests in 1950. Shannon information theory, possibility of chess-playing computers, tracing back to Boole, Aristotle, Euclid, logics and syllogisms. Knowledge-based systems, 1969-1999. Now we can see here we have named Dendral, Mycin, eMycin, Prospector. These are famous expert systems in the area developed with the help of concepts of AI. Dendral, the first knowledge intensive system determining 3D structures of a complex chemical compound. Now Mycin, the first rule based expert system containing 450 rules for diagnosing blood infectious diseases. eMycin and ES Shell. Prospector, first knowledge-based system that made significant profit, geological expert system for mineral deposits. Now, these all expert systems, they help individuals or human beings or scientists in a particular type of problems. For example, in the case of AI became an industry in 1980-1989. Widespread applications in various domains were made. Commercially available tools also are available. Current trends 1990 to present: more realistic goals, more practical application oriented, distributed AI and intelligent software agents. Resurgence of neural networks and emergence of genetic algorithms. Now let us have a look how the knowledge can be represented, reasoning, issues and attributes. Knowledge representation. It refers to the data structure, technique and organizing notations that are used in AI, and they are semantic networks, frames, logic production rules and conceptual graphs. The knowledge that we acquire can be stored inside the computers through the help of data structures. Organizing the notations that are used in AI, basic notations that are used in AI are semantic networks, frames, logics, production rules and conceptual graphs. Now, the knowledge acquisition encompasses a range of techniques that are used to obtain domain knowledge about an application for the purpose of constructing an expert system. We need to express, in order to prepare a knowledge-based representation, we need to express the general facts or beliefs in using a language and determine what else we should not believe. Now let us have an example here. Now in this particular example, we see a blue color box, a red color box, and a green color box. Let us frame a sentence for it. The red block is above the blue block. The green block is above the red block. So therefore, we can infer from the above two sentences as the green block is above the blue block. The block forms a car. So these are the inferences that we can draw by reading these sentences carefully and analyzing them. Let us take another example here. If it is sunny today, then the sun shines on the screen. If the sun shines on the screen, the blinds are brought down, the blinds are not down. Now in this particular sentence, we can also infer whether is it sunny today or not. So we can find an answer from it. So by just reading and thoroughly reading this particular sentence, that is, if it is sunny today, then the sun shines on the screen. If the sun shines on the screen, the blinds are brought down, the blinds are not down. Now this last sentence, the blinds are not down, indicates something for us. It is giving us a clue out of these sentences which will help us in replying. Now in this particular thing, is it sunny today? This helps in replying with that. So the blinds are not down, it means it is what? Not sunny. So knowledge representation language needs to be expressive, unambiguous, flexible. The inference procedures need to be correct, sound, complete, efficient. The major languages that are used for designing the knowledge-based systems, we can have an English, which is a natural language, we can use that. We can use Java programming language, we can use logic, special knowledge representation language. A language which tells us how to build up sentences in the language, for example, that is called as the syntax. And what the sentences mean, it is the semantics. An inference procedure which tells us which sentences are valid inferences from other sentences. Now let us start with the propositional logic. The symbols of propositional calculus are propositional symbols P, Q, R, S, truth symbols true or false, and connectives. The first one is AND, OR, NOT, implication, and equality. The propositions are elementary atomic sentences that may be either true or false but may take on no other value. There are rules for writing sentences in propositional logic. The syntax governs the combination of basic building blocks of propositional calculus such as propositions and logical connectives. Some of the examples of propositions are: it is very hot. The sky is overcast. Rama and Pragya have two children. These are all propositions. The compound propositions are formed from the atomic propositions using the logical connectives not, and, or, if, then, and if, and only if. Now in these sentences, these are compound statements. It is too hot and the wind is blowing. So what do you mean by compound sentences? Compound statements. The compound statement means that it is made up of two or more sentences which can be broken up like this. It is hot and the wind is blowing. It can be broken as it is hot, the wind is blowing. If you study hard, then you will be rewarded with good marks. The difference of 30 and 10 is not 15. propositional calculus sentences. Every proposition symbol with truth symbol is a sentence. Example 2, P, U, Q, R, negation. In order to show negation in a sentence, if you put that symbol, negative negation symbol, against any propositional variable P, or we can say it is negative sentence. Conjunction or AND of two sentences is shown as P AND NOT P. Now in this particular, P is a proposition, AND is a connector, and NOT is also a connector, and P is proposition. Disjunction or two sentences is a sentence. Example, P OR NOT P. Now disjunction is an OR operator. Implication of one sentence from the other is a sentence. Example, P implies Q. Equivalence of two sentences is a sentence. P or Q implies R, is equal to R. Legal sentences are also called well-formed formulas, WFFs. An interpretation of a set of propositions is the assignment of truth value, either T or F, to each proposition symbol. Symbol true is always assigned T, the symbol false is always assigned F. The truth assignment of negation, negative P, where P is any propositional symbol, is F. If the assignment is P to T, and is T is the assignment of P, is F. The truth assignment of conjunction, that is AND, is T only when both the conducts have truth values, as we know from the AND truth table that both the A and B variables should have T, and then only the output will be T, otherwise the output will be F. The truth statement of disjunction OR is F only when both the disjuncts have truth value F, otherwise it is T. All these rules we shall be seeing through the truth table also in the next forthcoming slides. The truth assignment of implication is F only if the premise or a symbol before the implication is T, and the truth value of the consequent or the symbol after the implication is F, otherwise it is T. So we can see that implication, we'll just read it again. The implication, it is very essential, it will be used in several times in propositional calculus. Now we see again it, this one, implication, it implies is F only when the premise or the symbol before the implication is T, and the truth value of the consequent or the symbol after the implication is F, otherwise it is always T. The truth assignment of equivalence is T only when both expressions have the same truth assignments for all possible interpretations, otherwise it is F. Now we can see here, for propositional expressions P, Q, R, these are the sets of rules. Now the first one shows negation of negation P equivalent to P. That is, if we perform the negation two times or double negation, then the original proposition appears. P or Q equal to negative P, P implies Q. Contrapositive law, De Morgan's law, commutative law, associative law. Associative law again we have seen. Distributive law again. So all these laws we shall be using in the forthcoming lectures in order to solve the problems. Now if you see here, this is the truth table for AND operator. If you see that if we have two propositions P and Q, and we want to perform P and Q, then you can see from the truth table that when both P and Q are T, the output is T, otherwise it is false, as stated earlier. Now if you see this particular implication, that is P implies, if P implication Q, then in this case it is equivalent to negation of P or Q. So what we have done, in order to prove the table, we have taken proposition P, we have taken proposition Q, then we have negated P, then we have found out the ORing of negation of P or Q, and then we have found out P implies Q. according to the rules, and then we have combined and to see that the results are equal. So we have given different four different, since there are two variables, we have given four different values to P and Q. So if we see here, if we give T and D to P, so negation of P is F and negation of P or Q is 2. Because in an OR operator, one of the propositions is true, then the output will always be true. So we can see this particular thing. So we will take another thing in propositional calculus. If it is sunny today, then the sun shines on the screen. If the sun shines on the screen, the blinds are brought down. The blinds are not down. Is it sunny today? So we can represent this overall sentences through propositional statements. P, let us call P as it is sunny today. Q, the sun shines on the screen. R, the blinds are down. Premise. So let us write a premise. P implication Q, or Q implication R, and not R last. So the question P, is it sunny today? So we have to frame the propositions in this way. So what we have done, we are allocating each part of the sentence which can be segregated as a single propositional symbol. For example, P, it is equal to, it is sunny today. Now in Q, the sun shines on the screen, the second part. R, the result, we can say result, the blinds are down. The premise, P implication Q, Q implication R, and not R, question P. Now let us prove this through the truth table. You will find that there are three variables, P, Q and R. We will take three different parameters, three different values for P, Q and R. So we have constructed a truth table to make you understand the facts. P, Q, R, T, T, T. The first one that we see here, P implication Q is T and Q implication R is T and not of R. You can see that the first value of R is T, but in not of R means F, and the conclusions P is T and negation of P is F. So this way we are trying to solve the whole of that truth table. The propositional logic is calculus is slightly cumbersome, and we can see through these following sentences. If it is sunny today, then the sun shines on the screen. If the sun shines on the screen, the blinds are brought down. The blinds are not down. Is it sunny today? If it is sunny today, on a particular day, then the sun shines on the screen. If the sun shines on the screen, the on a particular day, the blinds are brought down. The blinds are not down today. Is it sunny today? So it is slightly complicated. The terminology for the compound statements, P implication Q, P is called the premise. Now you have to understand what do we mean by the propositional calculus, parts of the propositional calculus. Here, P implication Q means P is the premise, hypothesis or the antecedent. Q is called the conclusion. Now from P you have to derive the conclusion Q. Q, now let us have a look at Q implication P is the converse of P implication Q. Negation P implication negation Q is the inverse of P implies Q, and negation Q implication negation P is the contrapositive of P implication Q. Now let us see through the examples. Implication. What do we mean by implication? If this book is interesting, then I am staying at home. Converse. If I am staying at home, then this book is interesting. Inverse. If this book is not interesting, then I am not staying at home. Contrapositive. If I am not staying at home, then this book is not interesting. So, let us have a look at the inference rules, how to deduct the inferences. The inference rules of a propositional calculus provides the means for logical proofs or deductions. Problem is to prove the truth or conclusion given the set of statements S, S1, S2, S3, so on, Sn, the premises. The use of truth table to do the form of semantic proof. The following are the rules. Modus ponens. From P and P implication Q, infer Q, and this is written as, for example, it is written as here as shown in the diagram, P and P implication Q is Q. So let us have an example of this. Given Jacob is a father, and Jacob is a father implies Jacob has a child. Conclude, Jacob has a child. So we can see that if we indicate P as Jacob is a father and Jacob has a child as Q, therefore from modus ponens we are going to get the result Q, which has been indicated as Jacob has a child. Now what is tolerance? From Q and P implication Q, we can infer P, and this is written as P implies Q and P implies Q, and we get P. Now let us have an example here. Jacob has a child denoted by P. Jacob has a child, it is denoted by Q, and Jacob is a father denoted by P proposition. Jacob has a child Q, so therefore it is Q and P implication Q, and the conclusion is Jacob is a father P. Now next is the chain rule. From P to Q, if P implies Q and Q implies R, we infer P implies R. It can be written as P implies Q and Q implies R. It means P implies R. Substitution. If S is a valid sentence, then derived from S by consistent substitution of the proposition is S valid. Example, P V naught is valid, therefore Q V naught Q is also valid. Simplification. From P and Q infer P. Conjunction. From P and Q infer P and Q. Transposition. From P implies Q, infer negation Q implies negation P. Formal system. A formal system is a set of axioms X and a set of inference rules L from which new statements can be logically derived. Properties of statements. Satisfiable. A statement is satisfiable if there are some interpretations for which it is true. Contradiction. A sentence is a contradiction that is unsatisfiable if there is no interpretation for which it is true. Validity. A sentence is valid if it is true for every interpretation. Valid sentences are also called tautologies. Equivalence. Two sentences are equivalent if they have same truth value under every interpretation. Logical consequences. A sentence is a logical consequence of another if it is satisfied by all the interpretations that satisfy the first. More general, it is logical consequences of other statements if and only if it is true for any interpretation that holds good for these statements. Only if it is, for example, P is a logical consequence of P and Q because it is true for any interpretation that holds good for P and Q. Now let us have a few examples for propositional logic that will make the things more clear. Let us have the first thing. It will provide you with proof of premises consisting of propositional symbols. Now let us take one problem here. Write the following statement symbolically and then make the truth table. If I go to the mall or go to the movies, then I will not go to the gym. I'll read it again. If I go to the mall or go to the movies, then I will not go to the gym. Now let us have the solution. Now let us represent it with the help of symbols, propositional symbols. P, I shall go to the mall. I go to the mall. Q, I go to the movies. R, I will go to the gym. Now the proposition can be represented or expressed as if P or Q, then not R. So it can be written as P or Q's as shown the symbol implication negation R. This is equivalent to negation of P or Q or negation R. This can be proved with the help of the following truth table. You can note down the truth table and you can see that we have P, Q and R are the variables and or the propositions. So we can have, since there are three propositions P, Q and R, we can have eight different values. So here in this particular table shows eight different values. T, 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 the first one, T, T, F, T, F, T, T, F, 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 T, T, F, T, F, 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 D, F, F, F. From, so we can see that we have different values from 1, 1, 1 to F, F, F. So if we see P or Q, we can see that P or Q, the results are T, 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 T for all. And wherever we have F, we are going to get the results as F. This is the ORing operation, similar to what we have done in earlier classes also. And F and F, we see that the final two at the bottom, they are F and F. Now the negation part, negation R. Now the original value is T, so it becomes F, F becomes T. So this is the meaning of negation. And then we have calculated P or Q implies R. So in this particular, P or Q implies not R. Okay, so here what we are seeing, F, T, F, T, F, T, 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 and then T. We can see that these are the values that we are obtaining from the propositions. And we can check that both the R column, negation R column, and P or Q implies negation R column, both of them are equal. So therefore, our example 1 has been proved. Now let us look at the next example. Drilling oil caused dinosaurs to become extinct. This is a proposition. How far it is to next town? It is not a proposition. Look out, it is not a proposition. We know that a proposition is a declarative sentence that is either true or false. Here some other examples of propositions we will be seeing. Now in this first one, that drilling for oil caused dinosaurs to become extinct. So there may be answer may be true or false or yes or no. So that is why it is a proposition. Now in the second case, if we look at look out, it is not a proposition because it is not answering true or false. It is not a declarative type thing. How far it is to the next town? True or false is not obtainable. For example, all cows are brown. True or false? Either the earth is further from the sun than Venus. The life on the Mars, there is a life on Mars. So we can see that this life on Mars is either true or false. Maybe it is true, we do not know exactly, or maybe it is false. 2 plus 2 is 5, the answer is, it has to be false. So therefore it is a proposition. Here are some of the sentences that are not propositions. Example, do you want to go to the movies? Since the question is not declarative sentence, it fails to be part as a proposition. Clean up your room. It is imperative and not declarative. So it fails to be part of proposition. Next example. 2x equals to 2 plus x. This is a declarative sentence, but unless x is assigned a value or otherwise prescribed. The sentence neither true nor false, hence not a proposition. Next example. The sentence is false. What happens if you assume that the sentence is true? False. This example is called paradox and is not a proposition. Because it is neither true nor false, each proposition can be assigned one of the truth values. We use T or 1 for true, F or 0 for false. Now let us have a look at the summary of logical operators. The unary operators, negation, not P, it is indicated with a particular symbol, not P. definition, binary operators, conjunction between two propositions P and Q, it is shown as P and Q. Disjunction or operator or connector P or Q. Exclusive or exactly one of P or Q, that is P, X or Q, it is represented with a particular symbol as shown here. Implication. If P then Q. So what do you mean by implication? Implication means if P is true then Q. Biconditional. P if only if, and it is written as double sided arrow. Now in this particular thing, let us have a discussion. A sentence like I can jump and skip, it can be thought of as a combination of two sentences, I can jump and I can skip. When we analyze arguments or logical expressions, it is very helpful to break a sentence down to some composition of simpler statements. We can create compound propositions using propositional variables such as PQRS and connectives or logical operators. A logical operator is either a unary operator, meaning it is applied to only a single proposition, or a binary operator, meaning it is applied to two propositions. The truth tables are used to exhibit the relationship between the truth values of a compound proposition and the truth values of a component propositions. So, with the help of this particular summary discussions, we can analyze the various problems that we'll be discussing in the subsequent classes. Now let us have a look at how the particular symbols negation can be represented with the help of certain examples also. Let us see. Negation operator, it is called not operator, or it is represented with a particular symbol. And this book is interesting. Let us say this is a statement. And we can represent it with negation P, as this book is not interesting. Or we can represent it with the second sentence, this book is uninteresting. Third sentence, it is not the case that this book is interesting. So a negation operator is a unary operator, which when applied to the proposition P, changes the truth value of P. So what do we mean by changes the truth value of P? It means that it is going to change the value, say so earlier it was T, it will make it to P, F. That is the negation of proposition P, denoted by negation of P. It is the proposition that is false when P is true and true when P is false. Another notation commonly used for negation is this particular symbol, as you have seen on the keyboards. This particular symbol is available directly with the help of shift keys. Now let us see the truth table for negation. So what the sentence that we have written, negation will change the original value of a proposition from one state to the other. For example, the first value is T, though it is made as F, F is made as T. Now let us see the second, conjunction. The conjunction operators, the symbol is AND. Now for example, this book is interesting, I am staying at home. So if we have a conjunction of these two statements, then we can write P and Q, which means this is book is interesting and I am staying at home. This AND operator is as shown here. Now the truth table is as shown here. We already know that the AND operator will be true only when both the propositional values are true. For example, here the first row it is T and P, and the output is T. So when last if we observe F and F, the output is F. Now let us have a look at disjunction. The disjunction operator inclusive or with a symbol V. Now let us see the sentences, statements. The book is interesting, I am staying at home. P or Q, the book is interesting or I am staying at home. Now this is the or disjunction that we have used here. Now we can see the truth table. P, Q, P or Q, T, 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 and F, F, it is F. So you can see this. So, now next one, exclusive OR. The exclusive OR operator XOR has a symbol. This particular symbol is there for exclusive OR. Now, if we want to perform exclusive OR for these sentences which we have dealt earlier, that is, this book is interesting, I am staying at home, P exclusive OR Q. Either this book is interesting or I am staying at home, but not both. Okay, so this exclusive OR operator is as shown here. The truth table, if you see here, the truth values are true only when the both the values are same. For example, if you see the first row, it is T and D, the output is T, and if it is F and F, the output is T. So in other cases, when the opposite outputs, inputs are there, the output is false. Output is false in the second and the third row case. Now the implication. The implication operator, if then, and it has got a symbol as shown here. For example, if we take the same example here, this P, the book is interesting, Q, I am staying at home. So P implies Q, or P implication Q. If this book is interesting, then I am staying at home. So let us prove it through the truth table. We can see that the truth table has been formed here. It is having four different values. If P value is T and Q value is T, the output is T. If the P value is T and Q value is F, therefore it is F. Earlier also I have told you that implication is false only in one case. That is, the antecedent, if the antecedent is positive or true and consequent is false, then the output is false. In all other cases, we can see that it is true. So, we have observed different variables. We have put different propositional values for P and Q, and we have observed the implication here. So, we can read from the previous definition of implication. We can see here that the implication is false only in one single case, and it is true in all other cases. So let us have further look into this. If P then Q, we can be P implies Q, if P comma Q, P only if Q. So this is the way of representation. So but you have to understand the different premises. Let us have a look at biconditional operator if and only if, which is as shown in the slide. Let us take the same example. P, this book is interesting. Q, I am staying at home. So, by P biconditional operator Q, this book is interesting if and only if. Now, you see this arrow based symbols, both side arrow based symbol has been replaced with if and only if I am staying at home. I am reading the sentence again to make you understand. This book is interesting if and only if I am staying at home. So, this is a biconditional operator. Let us prove it through the truth table. So, again, we know that there are only two propositions, P and Q, and the last column, P biconditional operator Q. Let us see the results. Now, this biconditional operator, you see that in the first row, when both the values are true, the output is true. When both the values are false, as shown in the fourth row, the value is true. In rest other cases, it is false. The biconditional statement is equivalent to P implies Q and Q implies P. So you have to understand that since we are using a double-sided arrow, so this can be broken down into two things, with an AND operator, that is P implies Q and Q implies P. In the other words, if and only if Q be true, must have both P and Q true or false, as shown in the table. When we set out to prove biconditional statements, we often break the proof down into two parts. First, we prove the implication P, Q, and then we prove the converse Q implies P. the difference between the implication and biconditional operators can often be confusing because it is going to create a problem for understanding. So let us have slightly more details. In our everyday language, we sometimes say if-then statements, which implies P to Q. When we actually mean the biconditional statements, it is this. Consider the statement you may have heard from your mother. If you eat your broccoli, then you may have some ice cream. The following distinct logical meaning of the first statement, the child still may or may not have ice cream, but if the broccoli isn't eaten. The if-then construction does not indicate what would happen in the case when hypothesis is not true. The intent of this statement, however, is most likely that the child must eat the broccoli in order to get the ice cream. This is the final thing. Now the NAND operator, NAND and NOR operators, let us have a look at them. The NAND operator is the Schaeffer stroke as shown here, and the truth table is as shown here. It is T and T, then we get NAND output as F. T and F, we get the output as T. F and T, the output is T. S and F, the output is F. In the case of NOR operator, which is as shown with a Pierce arrow, downwards arrow, and let us have a look at the truth table. P, Q and P, Pierce arrow, Q. When T and T, it is F. When T and F, it is F. When it is F, T, it is F. F and F, it is T. So we are following the same logics as we have learned in digital electronics. The same logics we are applying here. Logic will remain the same. It will not change. NAND and NOR you have implemented as gates. The inner NAND gate, it means it is the negation of AND. So if we see NAND table, if we perform ANDing operation between T and T, it is going to be T. But if we negate it, it becomes false, which is the first row output. As shown here, T and T, it is F. Now let us have a look at the fourth row of the NAND table. F and F, if we perform ANDing operation between F and F, we are going to get F. And if we are performing the negation, the output is this way. And in the case of NOR operator, we are going to get the OR and for example, the first row T and T, it is the F. T and T is 2 and then we are going to get the F. Now suppose the proposition, the apple is delicious and Q is the proposition, I ate the apple. Notice the difference between the statements below. Negation P and Q, that is, the apple is not delicious, I ate the apple. Negation of P and Q, it is not the case that apple is delicious and I ate the apple. So we have attempted the propositional, today we have attempted the propositional logics, and along with it we have attempted the definition of artificial intelligence, definition of agents, and we have discussed the issues related with artificial intelligence. We have also discussed the history of artificial intelligence. This is all for today, and in the next lecture we shall try to cover the next set of things which are meant for the representation of knowledge. Thank you.